Thank you very much to Helen and Nancy for that rousing introduction. Feels like Christmas at the Met or something like that. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship today. If you're joining us online, welcome to you as well. Great to have you with us to spend a little bit of time with us. I'm Reverend John Smith, and we're at Port Elgin United Church, and this is the second Sunday of Advent, December the 4th. How quickly the year is going. Once we hit Advent, it just, before you know it, it's the new year. A couple of things before we start. I'm just about fully subscribed with actors for my Christmas play. However, guess what? The two main characters of a Christmas play are Mary and Joseph. Yes? Could you have a Christmas play without a Mary and Joseph? We might be doing that. So if you have it in you to pretend you're a young parent just about ready to have a baby, that would be wonderful. I need two actors for that. So please speak to me after church. We handed out prayer tags, and you don't need those right now, but if you did get one, you'll need one later on in the service. And I'm just realizing I don't have one either. So June is going to... Oh, thank you so much. We're talking about angels. Thank you very much. Next week, our theme is going to be gifts of kindness. And what I'm hoping to do is to hear some stories from you about your gifts of kindness and the impact that it's had on people in your lives. So I'm giving you fair warning. A week from now, I'm going to be asking. All right, I'm going to be asking stories about kindness. I also have some book recommendations to make about kindness. A few years ago, I did a whole study on kindness with a group, and we came up with a book list for kids on kindness. And if you're interested in that, I'll bring some books along next week for that. This week, I do have books to show you out on the table with the green tablecloth. If you're interested in having a look at those, they're books that I have sort of, you know, approved for kids under 10, if you're interested in looking at. The last thing to say is that next Sunday, after church, we're having a meeting to talk about our budget. And it's going to be one of those serious church-type meetings where we actually really do take a look at the budget and decide whether or not this is something we can do together for 2023. Okay, so that's next Sunday after church. Participating in our worship today in the tech booth, we have John Memberlo and John DeYoung. Thank you very much. We have Brian Schnitker and Terry Lenneman lighting our Advent candle in just a moment. Grace Reaney is reading our scripture. And of course, you've already heard Nancy and Alan on music. So thank you all very much. We'll begin with our opening prayer. Let us pray. O God, on this second Sunday of Advent, we pray for the healing of hearts that hurt. We pray for the healing of the nations at war with one another. We pray for the peace Jesus offers when we follow his way and his word. We pray that we might see peace in each other's hearts and reach out with open hands and open hearts. We pray that peace will find its way into our spirits during this soulful time of Advent. May we be about the making of peace today, tomorrow, and each day of the rest of our lives. In the light of Christ we pray. Amen. And now it's time for our Advent candles. Thank you.
stay working.
Today we light the second candle of the Advent season. It is the candle of peace. Everyone wants peace. Everyone wants to live in a world of peace. But peace comes from within. It starts in the heart of you and me. In Isaiah, the scripture says, "You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is set on you," which means we can find peace if we center ourselves in God's love for us and for each other. Peace is the byproduct of our love for God. When we live our lives full of the peace of God, we will be able to see others not as strangers, but as friends. And this is how peace will grow into our heart. We have peace also.
Thank you.
And that was your Latin lesson for the day. Gloria in excelsis Deo means glory to God in the highest. Right? Glory to God in the highest. And I don't know about you, but I was always taught to say it, eggshells. 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 I don't know if that's right or not, but that's right. Let's come to God in prayer. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for being the God of second chances. Thank you for being the God of third, fourth, and fifth chances. Thank you for showing us the path over and over again, for picking us up when we fall, and setting us back on the path again. On the path, we have learned to be kind, to be at peace within ourselves and with others. Thank you, God, for showing us that the darkness need not overwhelm us, that the dawn will come, that new life will break through, such that we can breathe again, such that our souls can be restored again and again and again. On the path, we have learned to trust our souls, for we know your presence is deep within us, like a woman ready to give birth. Thank you, God, for the stories of Christmas and Advent. Thank you for giving these to us each year, so that because we have changed inwardly, we can hear the stories differently again. This year, we pray for peace. We pray for hope. We pray for love to blossom in the desert, in the dark, in our loneliness, in our worry about the future. On the path, we have learned that your presence never leaves us. In the most difficult moments of our lives, your love still holds us. In this Advent time, O God, send your angels of hope and peace to remind us once again of the path you have shown us, down which you will lead us again. We pray in the light of Christ. Amen. Well, thank you to the worship team for leading us today, and they're going to lead us in a rousing version of the Virgin Mary.
Thank you.
going to have to learn to dance to that one. But you can't just stand still and sing that.
The first reading is Isaiah 11, 1 to 10. A shoot will come up out of the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him. The spirit of wisdom and of understanding. The spirit of counsel and of might. The spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, or decide by what he hears with his ears. But with righteousness will he judge the needy. With justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips, he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. The wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. And the second reading is Matthew 1, 18 to 25. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant with the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said to the prophet. Virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. May God bless the reading of this word.
Thank you.
Well, I'm going to tell a story that I've told many times. I don't think I've told it here. But it goes like this. When I turned 50, I made a list of all the things that I wanted to do in that decade, one of which was to learn how to surf. Now, I had always wanted to learn, but had just never had the opportunity. Unfortunately, I didn't live in Hawaii or California. Anyway, my wife Joan and I went to Hawaii for an anniversary that year, and I said the one thing that I was going to do was to learn how to surf. So she joined me, and we both signed up for lessons. The day arrived. It was sunny and hot, beautiful, but the sea was choppy and vigorous, if you know what I mean. The sea bottom was really reefy, and so the prospect of falling might mean a lot of scrapes and bruises. The physical act of lying on the surfboard, and let me just give you a little picture of that. You lie on the surfboard and paddle out to where you're going to catch the waves. And when the waves are coming at you like this, that is actually the hardest part of surfing. It's paddling out. So we both managed to ride a couple of waves, but to be honest, we felt like the ocean had won that day. So a few days later, we went to a different beach on a different island. The waves were gently rolling in, maybe not quite big enough for surfing. The bottom was sandy underfoot, and we decided to give it another try. So we went into town, we found this young guy, a surfer dude, and asked him if he would show us how to surf again. And guess what? Before you could say Elvis Presley, we were up on our boards, surfing those waves right into shore. It was exhilarating, and we felt like champions. We were glad that we took the second chance. And because we did, we were able to redefine ourselves, redefine our identity, and to claim something new about ourselves for having done so. I haven't been surfing since, I can honestly say, but I consider myself a retired surfer. And now it's part of my identity. Now, I think this might be helpful advice for churches these days. These are such challenging times for the church in general, of course, and not just here at Port Elgin United Church, and certainly not the United Church of Canada. This is pervasive in our culture. What would we do if we got the chance to reset or reboot our church and start all over again? What would be the one thing that we would want to accomplish if we had the courage, the strength, the energy, and the resources? What would that one thing be? Now, we're all aware that Christendom, as we know it, is suffering the choppy seas and the crashing waves of what I call secularism. Secularism, more than anything else, has bred an ethos of indifference into our culture. Such that indifference, while not new to the church and certainly not reserved for the church, is kind of an ailment of our day. And the pandemic has exacerbated it. Indifference is kind of like, what do I care? As long as my little group is okay, I don't need to worry about anything else. And now, what's really interesting to me is that generally speaking, and I'm talking about young people and old people, I find most people today do have a sense of mission and purpose, and do want to see the world change for the better, and do want the world to become a more peaceful and loving place, but do not look to faith as a way to achieve it. And do not look to the church as a way to help them achieve it. Churches are a lot like the Eastman Kodak Company. Do you even remember them? The Eastman Kodak Company. When they received a report back in 2002, so 20 years ago, stating that it was clear that digital photography was going to take over the photo world. And the folks at Kodak didn't listen to their own research and development people who said, yes, this is definitely going to happen. We need to re-engineer our whole business model and change what we're producing, and et cetera, et cetera. And they said, no. What we have is time-tested and true. Analog film is the best thing that was ever invented, and we are not veering from our position. 10 years later, 2012, while Apple in the background developed cameras with phones and kept perfecting them every year, putting out a new and better edition, 10 years later, 2012, Kodak declared bankruptcy. Right? And that's 10 years ago. Look how much things have changed even since then in that particular world. And so it's a good analogy for the church, because the church of today, if it doesn't do some research, and if we don't change our ways about thinking of the world in which we find ourselves, and I'm not just talking about changing our message or the packaging of it, we're not going to make it, right? Our own research and development teams are already telling us this very thing. So perhaps there is some nobility in defeat, in maintaining our identity as a relic of the past or as some sort of cute anachronism. And maybe we actually want to waste time complaining that the bottom is too reefy and we're afraid we're going to fall and hurt ourselves if we try to learn something new, or that we don't have the strength to navigate the waves that are crashing upon us, all of which would be true. But it wouldn't change the fact that we'll be dead. God has always given a second chance to his people. I'm thinking about Moses, who killed a guy, ran off in the desert, and then God says, I want you to lead my people out of Egypt. During Advent, all of the Isaiah readings that we read about are all written in a time of exile, persecution, when the whole people of Israel had been carted off to Babylon. And during that time, guess what? They yearned for a second chance, right, to go back home to Israel and start again. They prayed for it, they longed for it, they planned for it. That second chance. For me, one of the most difficult pieces of baggage that we have in our faith, and what we're just going to have to leave on the side of the road, I think, is what I call the singularity effect, which is the idea that our gospel stories about Jesus are only about Jesus and are only applicable to him, and that there's no way whatsoever that any of us can be anything at all like Jesus, so full of God and the divine spirit. But this isn't what the gospels are telling us. The birth stories are about regular people. Joseph was a carpenter. Mary was a poor girl. They were not of noble stature. They were marginal people at best. Yet this is a sign to us when we read these gospels. You too, dear reader, it is the gospel saying, are worthy of God. You too have within you the divine light that was born in the Christ. Can you imagine how, in just the last 20 years or so of our life as a church, we could have spared ourselves a lot of ugly and searching if it had adopted this theology that everyone is worthy of God? And I'm telling you, it doesn't get more biblical than that. John's Gospel didn't read that today, but we will at Christmas time for sure read it. It tells us right off the bat, right off the top, that Jesus was born of light, of eternal light, which becomes flesh. Not one person's flesh. The Greek writer hides a very interesting thing in the Greek, and most of us don't speak Greek, so we don't understand that the word flesh in Greek means all flesh, not one person's body. If you're a Greek scholar, the word is sarx, S-A-R-X. It refers to the whole body of humanity. And so when we read that gospel now, we're going, wait a minute, the Word of God wasn't just born into Jesus' body, it was born into the whole body. The Word became flesh and dwelt within us. Do you hear the difference now that you know that? If we made that one change to our thinking, it could revolutionize the world. A Catholic priest by the name of Richard Rohr writes in a book called The Universal Christ that when we properly understand the word Christ, we will see the universality of it. We'll see the transcendence of God in every person. We'll see the immense spaciousness for love in every being. We'll see the infinite horizon of possibility when we place everyone inside the Christ. We'll see the fullness and the oneness of everything. And he goes on and on and says that even just re-understanding that the word Christ is not the personal name of Jesus, but the light that is born into the flesh of the world is really what Christ means. So that when someone says they see the Christ in you, this should blow your mind. Right? It is the eternal light of God living in you. Ultimately, this is the real meaning of the Christmas story. So every year, Advent comes along with its traditional stories, the same old carols we've always sung, not dancing to them because you were never taught to dance to them. They offer nostalgia and touchstones to an earlier, more innocent time, let's say, when everyone was Christian, and it was okay to call it Christmas, and people weren't allowed to shop on Sundays. You know that time, not so long ago. And we so want that time to come back. And so we wrap Advent and Christmas around us, and to induce perhaps, a reverie in which we feel for a few moments at least that there is a God and that God really does seem to love the world she gave birth to. And then as soon as we open the presents, we put away the leftovers from the Christmas dinner. We go and fall asleep in front of the TV. We find some way to admit we don't quite know how to fix the brokenness of the world outside our doors. So we turn away, fatigued and indifferent. Because that's what we've been taught to be in this world of ours. But Christmas. Christmas offers us a second chance, right? Another chance to be inspired by the birth of. We get that little moment. There is an opening, a window that opens in your tired little soul. That moment might be brief. It might be a flash of light or insight, but everyone gets it. We get this chance to be opened up like a present. To be opened up to serve the greater good, to offer ourselves and our teeny tiny gifts to the creation or recreation of a new world, because we learn and we believe that we can surf through the choppy waters of today, the secularism and the indifference. We can face the oncoming waves. We can get back on our surfboards, old Christians, so weary and tired of trying to defend ourselves in the world. Because guess what? We have the Christ light in our hearts, and we can see it in absolutely everyone else, including all the non-Christians of the world. It doesn't matter who you are. Our God, the God of second chances, always seeks to resurrect our little hearts and spirits. Every day, really, but has given us this gift of Christmas time for us to really get the message. It somehow, it has to happen in the darkest time of the year, in the coldest time of the year, when we're just about strung out and at the end of our ropes, and that's when that little light is born in a manger in a far-off place. Christmas connects us back to the light, right? To the light of God, to the energy of God. It's about seeing the light or the energy of God in every person. It's about seeing the light of God in every living thing, whether it's a forest or a Caribbean snake eel, which is a real thing, by the way. It's about seeing the light of God in each other, in our partners, if we look close enough again at them, in our kids, in our adopted family, in our friends, in the strangers we meet every day. Christmas gives us the second, the third, the 53rd, and the 89th chance to reconnect to the light of the world. And so, I think we have good news to share. I think we have a good news story. I think that we have to let some of the old bad news go and focus on the good news. And one thing I would say is that this world will only be saved when each of us sees the Christ in every other one. So just let's make it real for a moment. When Kanye West tweeted out to his millions of followers that Nazism was good, and that Hitler was right, and that the Jews should have learned their lessons, we have to stand up to him, because that is wrong and evil and bad, yes? We have to tweet back or post on our own social media that we think everyone carries the light of God, right? That's our message. Everyone carries the light of God. Why aren't we posting it on Facebook every single day? Or Instagram or whatever we use. We have to take a stand. We have to proclaim our message into the world. For some reason, the church and its people have stopped doing that. If we don't use Twitter or Facebook, write a letter to your local newspaper. And at the very least, have a conversation about it at your dinner table today. Or at Christmas when you have your kids with you. It's too important not to discuss it. And I'm telling you that at this day and age, we are being given a second chance to get the message out into this world that sorely needs to hear it. Here's another example. Next spring, the Canadian government is going to make it easier for people with mental health issues to choose MAID, right? To choose medical assistance in dying. The rise of MAID deaths is the most pressing ethical and religious issue in our country today. And yet, I ask you, how can a secular society deal with something that has huge ethical, religious, and moral aspects to it? You see the difficulty? The air that we breathe is secularism, and yet we have to deal with these great big issues. I haven't heard a single church organization discussing MAID in the last 6 years that has been allowed in this country. I haven't heard anyone discussing it in our local churches. And perhaps you have seen how our Veterans Affairs Agency is actively counseling veterans who are sick or suffering from mental health issues in particular to consider ending their lives by MAID, which in my view is unconscionable. It's ethically and morally wrong. It seems like an excuse rather than taking seriously the very real mental and physical challenges faced by our veterans and offering them programs to help. Veterans Affairs is not looking at a person as the vessel of the light of God. Veterans Affairs is us. We've stopped looking at people as if they bear the light of God. If we can't see how Christmas is a message that will change from what we say and do, then we've stopped trying to surf those waters because the conditions are too murky, yes they are, and the waves are too vigorous. Yeah, they are. So friends, the only way for us to stop indifference and skepticism is to stop being indifferent. I care, right? When we watch the news, I care about this issue. I care about the veterans. And to stop being cynical, that there's nothing that we can do. It was the church that rallied the world and got Nelson Mandela out of prison to defeat apartheid. It was the church that started the first Truth and Reconciliation Commission, putting the whole world onto a different path for healing past wrongs. We have done great things. Christmas is giving us the chance to do it again. I pray that you will join with me to stand up for the sanctity and beauty of every living thing this Christmas. Amen.
So
We're talking about angels in Advent this year, and angels bring tidings. What are tidings? Right, tidings are messages of goodness, of good things to come. Right? I bring you good tidings, we might say, or sing. And a lot of our Christmas carols talk about tidings of comfort and joy. They're messages of good news. So during the prayer, you have been given one of these tags, and I would like you to write down a tiding that is happening in your life. Could be small, it could be huge. It's good news, whatever it is. It could be something that brings you comfort or something that brings you great joy. It could also be a prayer for someone in your family. After the service, so not now, but after the service, I'd like you to bring them to the front. And hang them on a tree. Tidings of comfort and joy. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for the good news in our lives. For the days that are full, and for the days that are full of quiet. For the energy of children at this time of the year. For the energy of new life still coursing within us. For the ability to give and to give away. Thank you, God, for loving our world despite the mess it is in. Thank you for those who work against injustice and racism and anti-Semitism. Thank you for those on the front lines of healthcare, for those engaged in food security for our neighbors, for those who work long hours in our schools, for those who dedicate their lives to helping others. There are so many angels. Thank you, God, for loving hearts and open minds, for those in our lives who love and care for us, for those we care for, and for those who care for our loved ones. Thank you, God, for acts of heroism, for acts of kindness, for kids who make Christmas cards for seniors, for people who sing their hearts out, for the angels among us, young and old, for those supporting us, even unawares, for those who look out for us. God, help us to keep our eyes open to the goodness looming around us, and give us courage and strength to do our small part. And bring us all together into the comfort and joy of the birth of the Christ once again, in our hearts and in our lives. Now let's come together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Harp, Herald, Angel.
Christ beside me and to win me. Christ to comfort and restore me. Christ to guide me and protect me. Christ beneath me and above me. Christ in hearts of all that love me. Christ in quiet and in danger. Christ in mouth of friend and stranger. May Christ's love lead us into this Advent season with hope and joy and peace.
Amen. Thank you.